Let me start with chapter 3 of Introduction to Electrodynamics by DJ Griffiths. The title of the chapter is Special Techniques. Let me first give you a summary of these techniques. The last equation or law that we reached was Gauss's law. Now on that Gauss's law, we will apply the potential definition and the Poisson equation, which we will get from the Gauss's law. We will then convert it into the potential form, so it will become the Poisson's equation. And that Poisson's equation we will consider then in a region where there will be no volume charge density, rho will be equal to zero. And we will get the del square V or del square phi equal to zero. And this we call as the Laplace equation. So when we will solve the Laplace equation in one dimension, then we will get a straight line equation, which will tell us that there is no local minima or maxima in the equation. We will then go to the two-dimension and three-dimension solution, and we will keep ourselves to Cartesian coordinates. We will develop a method of images, means we will develop such a geometry with the help of which we can solve a given problem or a given geometry easily. In the three dimensions, we will use the separation of variable techniques and we will solve some geometries with different specifications. And finally, we will reach to the core of this chapter, which is the solution of the Laplace equation in spherical polar coordinates. In Cartesian coordinate, we will get very limited information, while in the spherical polar coordinates, we will have a lot of useful information. Like we will go through the Legendre polynomials, the spherical harmonics, etc. One thing you should note that when we will be solving those equations in spherical polar coordinates, then we will not be solving each and every step as per standard of this book, because the calculations are very lengthy, and you will find in your book that some direct results have been reproduced. So I will try to interpret those results, but will not derive all of them because there are so many mathematical steps involved. If you are interested in all the steps that how these things are derived, like the Legendre polynomial, associated Legendre polynomial, spherical harmonics, the orthonormality of spherical harmonics, then I have already uploaded the classical electrodynamics course by J.D. Jackson. And over there you can find those derivations. All derivations have been done over there. So when we will be done with the spherical polar coordinates, then we will go to the multipole expansions, and we will have the monopole, dipole, quadrupole and octupole terms. And this will end our this chapter. So basically the chapter is very mathematical in its nature. But we will try to interpret things which are involved in this chapter. So the very first thing, let me start with the Gauss's law. And Gauss's law is, you remember that the Gauss's law is E dot dA, and it was an integral on a closed surface. So it's a surface integral. This is basically the electric flux phi E, and this is equal to Q enclosed over epsilon naught. And we have also derived the differential form of this law is divergence of E is equal to rho over epsilon naught, where rho is the volume charge density. So in this equation, we know that the electrostatic, we got it from the electrostatics, and now we will convert this one into the Poisson's equation. And as we know that electric field can also be written as minus gradient of V, gradient of potential. This V we sometime write is phi. So in your book it is following V, so I will write V here, and this will make our divergence of E is minus gradient of V equals rho over epsilon naught, and then minus will come outside and del dot del will come out to be del square. So del square V equals the minus, we move to the other side, minus rho over epsilon naught. And this we call the Poisson's equation. And when we will be in a region that where we will have no volume charge, no volume charge density, means the rho is equal to zero there. Now what is that region? First understand this one, that we are in a region, or we are enclosing a region where we don't have any charge involved, but the field is there. So this is like that we are receiving electromagnetic signals from a far tower, mobile tower, and we are having the mobile with us. So in the region in which we are, we don't have any oscillating charge. The oscillating charge is there in the tower. So in that situation, we will have rho equal to zero, and this will make the Poisson's equation is del square V equal to zero. And this we call is the Laplace equation. So in all this chapter, we will basically solve the Laplace equation. So in the beginning of this chapter, you will find some uniqueness theorems, boundary conditions, and things like that. So let me first explain to you that what is meant by the boundary conditions, or what is the uniqueness theorem. If, for example, we are having a source somewhere, and there is a boundary we are having. Now on this boundary, we say that the potential means V on this boundary, if this boundary is equidistant from the source, then we will have, wherever we will measure the potential on this surface, then it is supposed to be an equipotential surface. And we will have, if we find the value of V at two locations, and this is V1, will be the solution of the Maxwell equation, or the solution of the Laplace equation will come out to be that the two potential, if the conditions are the same, then we will have a unique value for the potential. That is means the same equation or the same geometry cannot give us two values, but only one value it will give us. And this we call that the solution will always be a unique solution. We cannot have more than one solution for same geometry and same conditions. Similarly, on the same boundary, if V are the potential is the same, then the derivative of this thing will also be the same. And from here we can see that electric field is basically the space derivative of V. So I can write this one, that basically when this is same, then it means that dV over dr is equal, 1 is equal to dV2 over dr, and this implies that even the electric field on the boundary will also be unique or the same. So this is something like wherever we specify boundary conditions on a surface or on a boundary, then we say that the quantity, the physical quantity, will remain the same on both sides of the boundary, and the derivative of that physical quantity will also remain the same. So these are basically the uniqueness theorem or the uniqueness of the solution. When we will solve the Laplace equation or the Maxwell equations, we must have a unique solution. We call then in classical electrodynamics by J.D. Jackson, we over there then gave names to these boundary condition, like the first boundary condition, that potentials should have the unique value, and then this we call the Dirichlet boundary condition, and the electric field is to have the same or unique values, we call it a Neumann boundary condition. So here I am not going into much detail in this one, but only to cover that the uniqueness theorem means that the solutions will be unique. We cannot have more than one solution for a given geometry. So that is one thing which is very crucial. Now here, when I write this equation, then I know that del square is curly square over curly x square, and V here plus curly square over curly y square, and V here plus curly square V over curly z square is equal to zero. And the del square is basically, if I take V out, then curly square by curly x square and curly square by curly y square and so on is basically the del square value, and del square of V equal to zero, and we will follow to solve this equation. Now let's see, we are solving the Laplace equation in one dimension, and I take one dimension from here. So this I can write is in one dimension, then I will not use the partial, but I will write the complete derivative. So del square V over dx square is equal to zero. And if I integrate both sides, then I will get that dV over dx is equal to a constant. And let's say I call this constant equal to m, for example. And then I do integrate both sides again. So I will have V of x equals to mx plus another constant. And let's say this constant is c. Now this equation is basically resembling the equation of a straight line, like we write y equal mx plus c, where c is the y-intercept. So this tells us that if we are having